It hasn't quite been a week, but the first official push to get voters' attention has begun in earnest since the writs were drawn up last Wednesday. Has it changed the conversation or the trajectory of how Ontarians are thinking about voting? Let's ask Erin Kelly. She's joining us every week during this Ontario election campaign to tell us what the artificial intelligence algorithm known as Pauly is seeing gain traction with voters. And there's Erin joining us now from the nation's capital. And without further ado, tell us, what's getting sticky out there? What's gaining traction?
Well, Stephen Del Duca, just right there, he is absolutely on fire. We have seen, Pauly has seen that his seat count has doubled in the last week, his projected seat count. He's gone from projected 10 seats to 20 seats just since the writ was announced. And that has been largely at the expense of the NDP. So we mentioned last week that Andrea Horvath, her messaging wasn't resonating. That is just picking up steam. She is losing seats. And if this continues, by this time next week, we'll probably see the Liberals in second place.
Erin, do we know what accounts for that?
Yes, it really. So what we're seeing is that NDP supporters and the NDP itself seems to be putting out a lot of messages around healthcare. And quite frankly, people are COVID tired. I understand why 6 months ago this was a good issue to strategize around. But today the issue really is affordability. And Stephen Del Duca has the best message on affordability. It's focused. It's easy to understand. And when it's easy to understand and focus, people share it in their network. They share it amongst their friends. So his messaging is just traveling a lot faster and much more efficiently than Andrea Horvath's. It's really translating into a big change in seat count.
Let's touch on an issue that the three so-called progressive parties, the Liberals, New Democrats, and Greens, all take one position on, in very big distinction to the current government of Ontario, the Progressive Conservatives, and that's Highway 413 to be built across the top of the Greater Toronto Area. What's Pauly saying about that?
I don't think it's an issue that is changing how people are going to vote.
So in other words, everybody sort of expects the Progressive parties to oppose it, they expect the government to favor it, and that's the end of it.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay, how about Dentacare? The NDP came out with a Dentacare announcement that seemed to get a lot of attention when it happened. What's Pauly saying?
Again, we're seeing that the NDP's policies are appealing to people who are hardcore NDP supporters, and there's just not enough of them to keep the momentum going. So it's not appealing to people outside of her demographic. And the other issue, I will just say while we're on the topic of her demographic, she's also brought out policies about freezing taxes for lower and middle income people. But we see that those people aren't discussing taxes. It's really higher income people who are in favor of tax breaks. So again, she's not hitting the mark that will enable her to grow her base or to grow her seat count.
Okay. Lots of stories lately about healthcare staffing shortages. Nurses, doctors, not on the job oftentimes because they're fighting COVID-19 themselves, stress, burnout, et cetera. What kind of traction are you picking up on what the parties have to offer on those issues?
We're not seeing that. Really, people are seeing that the progressive conservatives, they've said that they're going to invest in healthcare and that they've learned their lessons from COVID. And people, the electorate, seem to trust that party will do that, and they don't feel that it's a reason to switch their vote.
Okay. Let me circle back on the Liberals issue. Stephen Del Duca, you mentioned off the top, because he made a lot of promises related to education during week one, hiring 10,000 new teachers, spending hundreds of millions of dollars building new schools, and billions on new schools and renovating existing schools, bringing back an option for grade 13 and so on. As Pauly looks at this, how much traction are those policies having?
Those policies are, they get traction among NDP supporters, so they are effective in getting some of that seat count from the NDP to the Liberals. Those issues are not taking from the PCs, which Del Duca does have to do, and he will best be able to do that by focusing on affordability. That really is the thing that is catapulting him right now, is the feeling that he understands voters. To the extent that any of the leaders are seen to understand voters, I mean, that's another issue. Engagement on this election is really low, and that's something we should discuss. People actually don't feel that any of the leaders, if they're being completely honest, have the right solution. But to the extent that anyone does, we're seeing more and more people leaning towards Stephen Del Duca.
All right. In terms of engagement, then, let's continue on that. Is what you're finding leading us, sadly, to the possibility that voter turnout will be really quite low?
Yes, I think that's a real risk in this election. Normally, when an election is called, there's some fanfare around it and we see engagement go up. We didn't see engagement go up at all when this election was called last week. It's the same people who are generally very interested in politics talking about issues. And here's the really interesting part. Young people, very underrepresented in the discussion, except young women. And there's a reason for that, if you want to get into vote switching drama.
Go for it.
Because there is a potential vote switching. We saw the first potential vote switching topic that came up this morning. You know, I mentioned last week that Polly, normally she looks at decided voters and then she looks at undecided voters. But this time we're going to look at vote switchers, because we saw in the last election, last federal election, a lot of conservative voters switched their vote from the conservatives because of the vaccine policy. So those are people who are lifelong conservatives who for the first time voted for a different party because of the stance that the conservatives took on vaccines. And so we decided to look at vote switchers again for this election. And we saw our first potential vote switching issue today.
Okay. What's the issue and from what to what?
So this is an issue that we've been tracking in the last, well, for 7 years, and we've never seen it come up in any Canadian election. And it's come up for the first time this morning, and that's abortion. Polly is seeing that this is a potential powder keg that's waiting to be lit. And that's why young women are much more engaged in the election, in election talk right now, than young men. Young men are saying, well, the PCs are going to win. This is in the bag. There's no point in me participating or me voting. Women are saying, there's a lot at stake here. I'm getting more engaged in this election, and I'm concerned that the conservatives, because healthcare is a provincial issue, and this is a conservative party. Now, people aren't worried about Doug Ford, but there are people in his party that are pro-life, and people are paying attention to that. And we do see some PC voters saying, if this issue comes up, and if I have any reason to think that that this party will lower women's right to choose, I will switch my allegiance. And they're overwhelmingly saying they will switch it to the NDP.
Interesting. Well, I well remember that the day that the American Supreme Court decision, or at least draft of a decision, was leaked, Doug Ford was asked about it on the campaign hustings, and he said, the U.S. Supreme Court has zero jurisdiction on the province of Ontario. He really tried to put this to bed quite quickly. Can you tell whether or not he has been successful in doing that?
He has not been successful in doing that. Now, it's not Doug Ford personally. If I were in the NDP strategy room right now, I would be looking for candidates in the PC party that I could poke to provoke them to say something controversial during this campaign, because the indications are that could unravel for the PCs pretty quickly. So right now, the PCs are pretty steady. They are in first place and they're in comfortable first place. But if there was one thing that could change that right now, Polly is identifying abortion as that potential issue.
Fascinating. Last week, you told us that there wasn't a huge undecided vote out there and that it didn't look like they were sort of leaning one way or another yet. Any change in that?
There's not a change in the undecided. The worrisome thing here is that the undecideds are, as it stands right now, there's a good chance they won't vote at all. I mean, we really are seeing low engagement here. So, and if there's low engagement, that favors the conservatives. So if you're a Liberal or NDP supporter, especially if you're a Liberal supporter and your allegiances are somewhat new, right? Like people are just hopping on the bandwagon last week. Liberal and NDP supporters are less likely to vote. So the main thing right now, I think, is to get this engagement up, to have issues that are exciting to people, that are easy to understand, and really to make people feel that you have a policy that can work. Right now, with the exception of Stephen Del Duca, people are feeling, okay, all the leaders are saying we're going to bring about housing affordability, but there's a belief that that's not going to happen. There's a lot of defeatism here among the electorate. So I think people have to get, the leaders have to get more specific. They have to really inspire confidence in a way they're not doing now, that they have a solution that is going to work and that the newspapers aren't going to say the next day, that's never going to work, because that seems to be what's happening right now. All the analysts come out and say, that's not going to work. And so they need to consult with the experts and have people say, yes, this is a plan that will probably work. And the first leader who can do that, who can actually get some momentum going, that they have a workable plan, will shoot up and hopefully get the engagement up on this election.
Well, let's see what issues might do that. You told us abortion had a chance to do that. You said Buck a Ride had a lot of uptake among the people who are on social media, and public opinion was reflecting that. Any other issues out there right now that you can see at this early juncture of the campaign that might get more engagement, or at least get the leaders offering something that would get people more interested?
Well, having a strategy around housing that people will believe and that seems credible and realizable in the next term, that would be the big vote winner right there. Affordability, cost of living issues, and keeping it very simple. Having tax breaks and stuff like that, tax breaks resonates with wealthier groups, but they're not the ones complaining about affordability. So you need to have something that appeals to the people who are having trouble making ends meet right now in the province.
Let me follow up on that, because, of course, I'll give one example here. Just before the election was called, the Progressive Conservative government offered a $1 billion rebate to people who drive cars, right? They said, you don't have to buy these license plate renewal stickers anymore, and in fact, we're going to send you a check in the mail to rebate what you paid last year. $1 billion out of the Treasury, and there's obviously arguments pro and con on the advisability of doing that. Similarly, the Liberals have promised with their Buck a Ride to subsidize urban transit use by to the tune of $1 billion as well. Do you have anything in your research which suggests that people see those as genuinely making life more affordable or more akin to trying to bribe me with my own money?
People liked the rebates on the license plates. We saw that was very good for Doug Ford. He's also getting credit for the child care deal, so people are really happy about that. So he's definitely getting kudos for that. And Buck a Ride is doing really well. So even though in that case, you know, the expert said, well, how realizable is Buck a Ride, or, you know, is this good for the Treasury? It definitely worked with the electorate because it's very easy to understand. You're giving me money. You're giving me money back. We're having being able to take the bus and it only costing $1, I can really understand how that helps me. I'm not sure how the tax cut will help me. Does it help me right now? I mean, it doesn't sound like it's more money in my pocket, and I need more money because food is very expensive and shelter is very expensive. So keeping the status quo isn't going to help me.
But it sounds like they're not making the connection, the voters anyway, are not making the connection that a $1 billion rebate today means inflating the deficit today, which means raising taxes or cutting programs tomorrow. They're not making that connection?
Absolutely not. If I need to pull out the spreadsheet to explain why this is or isn't a good policy, then you've lost me, right? It really, and that's what's killing it for Andrea Horvath. She's too complicated. You want something where you can say to your friends, hey, did you hear that if we vote for Stephen Del Duca, public transit's a buck a ride? That's easy to communicate. Pass it on, right? That just goes like wildfire. If I have to say, yeah, but if we put money into the economy now, that's going to make prices rise and inflation's going to get worse. Now I need like an economics degree to know what you're talking about. So it has to be, and this is the job of the leader, to have policies that are well-grounded. So you've done all that work in the background and are easy to communicate so that people can tell their neighbors about it.
Aaron, let me ask you one last thing, and that is, there was a book written, I don't know, maybe 2 decades ago by Thomas Frank called What's the Matter with Kansas? And the gist of the book, for those who haven't read it, was that it seemed that lower-income people were voting Republican in the United States, despite the fact that it could be argued that was against their own economic self-interest, but that they lined up with the Republican Party more in terms of values. You know, pro-capital punishment, anti-abortion, that kind of thing. Now, we're usually a few years behind the U.S. on those kinds of culture wars. Can you tell whether that's happening in this province right now?
It's happening to a, Yes, it is happening in that province now, in this province now. But it's still a small slice of the population. So Ontario is overwhelmingly, for example, pro-choice, and I haven't seen anybody talking about capital punishment. So we even looked up crime. We're specifically tracking crime, and nobody's really talking about crime as an issue in this particular election. So we have seen it in other elections. We definitely saw it in the federal election that conservative, those values are strong, and even among people, like you say, who are lower income and would benefit from some of the programs that Liberals and NDP are proposing, but they vote according to values. We definitely have that cohort in Canada. That's not playing right now in this election. It is playing, like I mentioned, on abortion, but it's because it's a pro-choice group, pro-choice kind of movement that's coming up in the electorate. We're definitely not seeing conservative values being discussed a lot right now for this particular election.
Understood. Erin, thanks for today, and we will talk to you again next week.
Great, thank you.
That's Erin Kelly, CEO of Advanced Symbolics, Inc.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.